You set?
Okay, everyone, we'd like to get started. So I want to thank everyone for being here. I'll acknowledge we have people from not only the Twin Cities campus here, but Minnesota Duluth, Gustavus, St. Cloud State, St. Thomas, North Dakota State. Have I forgotten anybody? If I have, I apologize. So it's my pleasure to introduce today Diane McKnight from the University of Colorado. Diane is the Association of Environmental Engineering and Science Professors Distinguished Lecturer for 2019-2020, and so we're part of her tour. Diane did all of her degrees at MIT and then went off to the USGS for 17 years before coming back to academia, and she's been at UC Boulder since with a stint at NSF, right?
3 years at NSF.
Yeah.
Yeah,
and so Diane is the director of the long-term ecological research facility down in the McMurdo Dry Valley in Antarctica, and she has won numerous awards. Some of the more recent ones are the Dalton Medal from EGU, and she's a member of the National Academy of Engineering. And with that, I will turn it over to Diane. Thanks for being here.
It's a real pleasure to be here, and someone was asking me, when was the last time I was in Minnesota? And I'm going to tell you the answer to that later on, but it's related to the theme of this talk. So I'll be talking about how the reactivity of dissolved organic matter in natural waters varies based on the source, but then there's also this geographical dimension. I put Antarctica in the title to make it seem more exciting, and I promise you there will be some Antarctic work. And I'll start off by highlighting what is dissolved organic matter and why does it matter. We define it as soluble compounds, organic compounds that are nominally less than 0.5 microns. There's sources from soils, leachates of leaves, also from microbial sources. I have another slide showing that. And it's measured as dissolved organic carbon. So that the material is generally about 50% carbon. It's not all carbon, but that's what we can measure to make this measurement. And typically, 50% of this pool of dissolved organic matter is humic material. This is the home of the reference collection for the International Humic Substances Society, which is an organization that's had a huge impact in terms of the study of this material over the last several decades. And so I like to come up with a new acronym, HDOM. Humic, D-O-M, which hasn't really been adopted very much, but is a way of thinking about this heterogeneous pool. And Matt has agreed to be a help with a demo that we're going to do right now in here, where we're going to, while I keep talking, he's going to help generate it before your eyes humic DOM. So here's another way of looking at this in sort of a more colorful way, where we have plants and soils, microbes from algae and bacteria, and then of course man-made organic pollutants that are also contributing to this pool. And the microbial DOM is happening all the time. We went to Antarctica because my colleagues and I, because this is a plant-free continent. So if we wanted to just study microbial DOM, we could go there. From the limnological point of view, it's one of the, thanks, that looks good. See if we can get that all, yeah, good job. The limnologists or the aquatic ecologists recognize that this is the largest pool of organic matter in lakes and streams. So larger than the aquatic organisms, even the fish. It's in terms of milligrams per liter, it's the largest pool. The other thing that has been understood over the last 15, 20 years is that streams and lakes are not just pipes, that there's a lot of processes that result in the evasion of CO2 to the atmosphere instead of storage of organic material in the aquatic systems, so that the land production isn't all going to the oceans. And so in terms of understanding carbon cycling, this matters. And then keeping in mind that half of this pool is the humic pool that is somewhat persistent and biologically recalcitrant is important to think about as we consider the global carbon budgets. Let's see. So another reason we should be thinking about this in the context of environmental engineering is that this humic fraction, and I've highlighted in brown here the roles of the humic DOM in particular, the light absorbing fraction of this pool acts as both a sunscreen for the aquatic organisms that grow in the lake and river. So it attenuates the UV light and also determines the depth of the photic zone where there is enough light for photosynthesis to occur at a certain rate. Similarly, the humic material can control the bioavailability of nitrogen and iron, buffering pH at these high DOC. So if you see a brown water, black water system, there's probably enough organic material to buffer the pH. And hydrophobic organic pollutants can partition into this humic fraction, and their transport can be controlled by how that humic fraction moves, not by just their solubility. Another point that my colleague Yo Chin and I have worked on is that this binding of the pollutants with the humic DOM can make that process of the pollutant degrading due to photolysis be photosensitized and accelerated. In the context of drinking water, there's been a lot of attention due to the production of chlorinated organic compounds as a result of the exposure of this organic pool to chlorine. So we have to balance the disinfection goal of drinking water treatment to the goal of minimizing chlorinated exposure of the public in drinking water to chlorinated organic compounds. So that's the reason we care. The point I'd like to make in this talk is that some of the ways we can think about this problem can be related back to how limnologists think in terms of carbon cycling in the natural environment, especially as we have changes in the natural environment, forest fires, all sorts of things happening, being driven by climate change, this framework can be useful. So I teach, let me back up. I teach an applied stream ecology class where I introduce the concept of the river continuum. I don't know if this is the background of this audience. This is a big idea that the stream and river ecologists came up with in 1980 to try to explain how going from the headwaters to the Mississippi, how these ecosystems change. And this hypothesis is very much driven by the availability of light. So in a traditional, or not traditional, but a typical forested ecosystem, the stream may be shaded by the riparian vegetation. Think of that. And that riparian vegetation is also a source of these leaves, for example, into the stream. And that makes the system more heterotrophic, that incoming organic matter is degraded. And then in mid-order reaches, which are fourth to sixth order reaches, the stream bank is further away. There's potentially more light that can drive algal growth, both in the benthos, the bottom of the stream bed, and in the water column. And then eventually, depending on how much sediment is retained by one dam or another and the downstream transect, the water becomes very turbid. We think of the muddy Mississippi And at the very highest order down here, there can be limitations on photosynthesis in the channel due to all that turbidity excluding the light. So this is the big idea about light. And when this idea was put forward, they actually had a hypothesis about dissolved organic matter. So many of the hypotheses in this river continuum concept were testable in terms of which kind of organisms would be in which part of the stream. But back then, they had an idea that the relative diversity of soluble organic compounds, that's this graph here, would be greatest in the first order stream reach and then decrease as the organic compounds leached from these leaves were mineralized or photolyzed or taken up. That was their hypothesis. All of the other hypotheses in the river continuum concept were great because they were testable. You could go out and sample different types of invertebrates and see that we have shredders, organisms that can shred these leaves when the streams are the headwater streams and so on. But back in 1980, we didn't have a way to test this hypothesis. So one of the advances since that time is we do have tools to get after this, and I'll be talking about that later on. So another result, however, of all the work that has been done is this idea that I just, that hypothesis, we know that that's not really quite what's going on, that the group has come up with a new hypothesis, thinking of the river as a chemostat, that there's a lot of integration and a downstream diminishing of the influence of terrestrial source areas results in an attenuation of the variability of the dissolved organic matter in terms of both concentration and potentially quality, but we're just going after that now. So this is a paper by a team led by Irina Creed that was published in the Canadian Journal of Fisheries and Aquatic Sciences, where the first paper about the river continuum was published, and we felt that was really cool. Here's an example data set of the DOC load and the DOC concentration by Matt Miller with the USGS and Water Resources Research. And here's the DOC concentration in the Colorado River, very big river. And you can see how it plateaus out at about 2 to 2.5 milligrams per liter. And we don't know yet what the variability is in that composition as we go down. But the hypothesis of this idea is that it becomes, from this point on, its composition isn't varying as much in this as it is in the headwaters. So there's two different ways that people approach studying dissolved organic matter. One is it's a heterogeneous mixture. We have all these organic compounds, and we can try to characterize this pool maybe with spectroscopic methods, such as measuring the ability to attenuate light or some fluorescence method. But we think of the DOC as a whole. Another way that has been advanced by the USGS scientists back in the early 80s is this idea of the DOM pi, where we recognize, just as I said before, that a certain percentage of this organic matter is humic-like. A major fraction is the fulvic acid fraction, which is soluble at any pH. And then there's these other pools of different chemical characteristics that we can think of them having similar characteristics in these different wedges. Well, why are there so many acidic fractions in the DOM pool? There's a fundamental chemical reason for this. The carboxylic acids greatly enhance the solubility of an organic compound. So as organic matter is degraded and oxidized, there's a formation of carboxylic acids. And this can make a larger molecule more soluble. So one other approach then is to use techniques that we might use to characterize the whole pool, to characterize fractions that we can isolate based on chemical properties such as molecular weight, or in the case of the IHSS, based on how it absorbs to particular resins. And here's a picture of rose quarry when we were in the Arctic. Here's an XA-D8 resin. Can you sort of see how it's dark at the top? So you run water through the top, the resin's white, it gets brown, and then you elute the resin with a sodium hydroxide solution, which ionizes all those carboxyl groups. And then that brown material doesn't want to stay on the resin anymore. And this is how we can isolate that fraction. And this approach pretty much works everywhere. And then we can desalt that fraction by taking out the sodium with a cation exchange resin, and then use chemical characterization such as nuclear magnetic resonance spectroscopy, measure the carbon and nitrogen content, look at the aromatic groups relative to the aliphatic groups from the NMR. If we get some preparative material, then we can do some chemistry with that. We can't get around this problem. Normally, organic chemists who use NMR, they have sharp lines in their NMR spectra. We have what we call, George Aiken used to call, humpograms, where we have these areas of the NMR spectra because there's heterogeneity and all these different molecules. We can't get around the heterogeneity even when we isolate a fraction. It's just an inherent part of what's going on. Another technique that we can use is fluorescent spectroscopy, which is potentially very powerful because the light that is absorbed by this colored organic matter can then, some of that will be emitted as fluorescence, and that inherently will tell us something about the chemistry of that light-absorbing molecule, because the wavelength at which that light is absorbed and emitted can be specific to a certain kind of chemical. It's not, people will refer to fluorescence as a fingerprint, but it's not just a fingerprint, because there has to be underlying chemistry for this to happen. And this approach has resulted in some indices that we can use, both this fluorescence index and the humification index. As a material, this colored material ages, it humifies, and the humification index, these relationships between different regions in this spectra will change. So here we have an excitation emission, an EEM. Any of you heard about EEMs? Where we look at, make like contour plots of areas of intense fluorescence. And so this Hicks index is based on fluorescence in this region, whereas the fluorescence index is based on how steep this decrease in fluorescence is with wavelength at an excitation of 370 nanometers. So these two indices are telling us about different types of different areas of the spectra. And this fluorescence index is 1.2 for terrestrial soil-derived material and leaves, and about 1.9 if it's all coming from algae. What that means is this is a steeper slope if there's more material just from algae and bacteria. Okay, so this is a bit of a background. There's lots happening that's related to how our world is changing in the area of dissolved organic matter. One of the phenomena that has been observed in the North Temperate region is increasing concentrations of dissolved organic matter. both in temperate regions and also in northern regions. And we're trying to figure out what are the drivers. One process that we, somehow this got messed up, but we'll just go with it. We know chemically that low pH suppresses the solubility of natural organic matter because these carboxyl groups that I mentioned are then protonated. They need to be ionized to be more soluble. So what's been happening around the Northeast and other regions is that acid rain has been ameliorated. So the soils are not as acidic, and so there's an increase in the pH of soils, and that could be a driver for increasing dissolved organic matter concentrations. I think this still works, where we have, this is an analysis that my Mike San Clements, who at NEON did when he was a postdoc, of the sulfate concentration in some lakes that had been in Mud Lake, where we looked over time where the DOC concentration and it had increased, and we looked at how the chemistry had changed. So when the DOC was lower, the fluorescence index was at a high value, indicating that this humic material was coming from the algae. But as the DOC increased and the sulfate concentration went down, the fluorescence index also went down, indicating a more terrestrial source of this increasing DOC. And to do this analysis, we analyzed archived samples from the EPA study of lakes. And people were like, well, they haven't been refrigerated, and what about this? I said, look, the humic material in natural water is 200 years old. I think it'll be fine sitting in a plastic bottle in a, and sure enough, that turned out to be the case. So I apologize for this being kind of messed up. But here's another example of the other trends that we can think about that are happening. As you probably, many of you may be aware here in the temperate North America and the Northern Hemisphere generally, the duration of ice cover has decreased between about 3 weeks. So I explained to my carbon skeptic, the climate change skeptics, you know, I point out, hey, the ice fishing season in Lake Wobegon has decreased by about 3 weeks. And that registers, they sort of, oh, really? I thought I'd tell you that story since you must all know about Lake Wobegon. But what that does is essentially turns on the lights earlier so that this algal production can start sooner. So under ice cover, primary production is limited by light availability. And so we can see how this may be changing the DOC concentrations in lakes and also reservoirs. In Colorado, we've been very fortunate that many of the reservoirs have DOC concentrations less than the 4 milligrams carbon per liter cutoff for which it is required to lower the DOC concentration prior to chlorination in order to limit production of chlorinated organic compounds. So we've been in this low DOC realm, and the drinking water utilities have been tracking increases in DOC concentration approaching or passing that 4 milligrams per liter in the late summer as there appears to be more algal blooms. And so this is a study that we participated in where we analyzed the chlorophyll A concentrations of lakes with higher DOCs. Here, this is 4 to 5.9 milligrams per liter. Higher, some of these had high chlorophyll A, 50 micrograms per liter. That's a green you can see, actually. And then the highest DOC set of lakes, even higher chlorophyll A. And then if we look at this fluorescence index for these lakes at this late summertime, we can see that this fluorescence index, the higher values occur for these higher DOCs, higher chlorophyll, further showing that some of this organic material that's dissolving is coming from the algae that are blooming in August and July. So this helps to explain what's happening. And I'd like to tell this story. We want to do, as limnologists, environmental engineers, we want to do translational science where we figure things out and people can use it. So we did a study in an alpine lake where we kept track of all the DOC inputs. We measured the chlorophyll every week. We developed a reactive transport model where we could predict for this lake how much DOC was produced as the phytoplankton grew and the chlorophyll increased. And we had coefficients. We had coefficients that we thought could be transferable and that this would be maybe could be used by the drinking water utilities. And we published this paper in Limnology and Oceanography in 2009. And then what happened? The next summer, we were approached, my colleagues, Fernando Rosario and Scott Summers, by the Colorado Department of Public Health and Environment, and said, great, we're going to do a study of 30 lakes and reservoirs in Colorado in the middle of in the high peak of the phytoplankton bloom. So all these data that I just showed you came from that statistical study. They didn't want to take our coefficients and keep track of all the inflow, but they were glad to do this pretty intensive effort sampling 30 lakes and reservoirs across the state in July and August to get that answer I just showed you and present it to the Colorado Water Quality Commission as analyzing the data to make the case for new regulations for high quality drinking water supplies to limit both the nitrogen and have essentially a chlorophyll standard. And when this presentation was made to the Colorado Water Quality Commission, who was arguing against it? The wastewater utilities. Because they like the blue baby nitrate standard of 10 milligrams per liter, but that's a lot of nitrogen if you're worried about algal blooms. So anyway, so I'm just saying that I'd like to share this story with audience where there's a lot of graduate students. You should publish your thesis. You don't know who's going to use it. You are all figuring out important, you're making important findings, and if you put it out there, there are people who need to make decisions on what to do now in our changing environment. And we can't even predict how they will use the data, but it's much more accessible if it's out in the literature. Okay, well, I promised to also talk about polar regions. Polar regions, we have the Arctic, which is more like this beaker, is another way of thinking about it. There's a lot of terrestrial vegetation. And right now, the Arctic is thawing out. We have fluxes of dissolved organic matter going to the Arctic Ocean that are much higher than they were 30 years ago. And as I mentioned, this organic material is colored and could potentially be influencing the duration of the Arctic sea ice, how the heat budget for the Arctic Ocean, especially in coastal areas, that's an active area of research. And I just wanted to show some data where an important process, as we think about this, is the potential photolysis of this organic material along that transit from quite a distance. And this was work that was done at Tulik Field Station, sampling water and headwater streams all the way out to Prudhoe Bay. So we have production of hydrogen peroxide, which can react with metals, and it's continuous sunlight at this time when the area is thawing and there's these fluxes. So here's a picture of Tulik Lake, and here's a picture of the team sampling Prudhoe Bay. They went on a public tour for Dead Horse Point and then got out their carboys at the end of the tour. I said, well, you know, we're just going to go out. But the next year, we actually collaborated with ASARCO, and we went out to Licktock Point and collected some water further off the coast where they collect water to put it back in the pipelines. It's really fascinating, but that's more scenic. But in any event, Rose Corey and my colleague Yo Chin, we collected samples along this gradient of water residence time going from a few days all the way out to 6,000 days along this flow path to see if we could see changes in chemistry. And I'd just like to point out a few. One difference was the percent nitrogen increase significantly. And if we think about this photolysis, that would tend to leave more nitrogen behind as we lose aromatic carbon and produce CO2. And the N15 also changed, so that told us about what kind of nitrogen groups are remaining. And then there was a range of aromaticity at the headwaters and then fairly stable as we went down, so it's still colored. We can also use this fluorescent spectra in a more sophisticated way to use parallel factor analysis to kind of dissect this fluorescent spectra and figure out how photolysis was changing. And let me go back. Okay. We could look at the ratio of some of these fluorescence components that we think are related to quinone moieties and figure out how they're driven, how those are particularly photolyzed in this process and change the redox activity. I kind of think so this percent loss of this particular quinone-like fluorophore was greatest along this flow path. So that's telling us something about how this reactivity and the ability of this material to react with organic contaminants may be changing. And the organic contaminants are significant in the Arctic because there's deposition of hydrophobic organic compounds that are volatile, and then they end up in the Arctic through this volatilization pathway. So that's another way this DOC is important. Another process that is important in this context is that these same quinone moieties that I taught that we could know fluoresce are also potentially involved in how this pool acts as an electron shuttle. So I have a cartoon, an animated cartoon, also courtesy of Rose Corey, showing how this works. So let's hope this. Here's an electron. We have the reduced, this humic material has now accepted that electron. And then that humic material can pass it on to a ferric iron. The ferric iron may be present in the environment, not as a solute, but potentially as iron oxide, which is less available to microorganisms in terms of electron acceptance, so this humic material can act as an electron shuttle. Should I do that again? We'll just, here it is. And now we have the ferrous iron. And then that ferrous iron is also another reactive species in the environment. and can mediate how nitrate reacts and maybe how nitrogen is incorporated into the dissolved organic matter pool. So as we think about transitions from oxic to anoxic environment, this can be happening everywhere. So going from the epilimnion, the hypolimnion of a lake, everybody got that? The hypolimnion are often anoxic, so this can be happening. And then this, you have more electrons coming from the sun. So this is a dynamic system, and we can think about how that fluorescence might change. So in the last part of my talk, I'd like to get at another major tool that is now being used to understand dissolved organic matter, which has to do with Fourier transform, ion cycloton, resonance mass spectroscopy. And here is a picture of a very big instrument at the EMSL lab at PNNL. And this generates data where we can characterize the molecular formula of different, this pool, remember that graph I showed, which, you know, we can characterize this. However, I like to emphasize that now we know the molecular formula. This isn't necessarily telling us which of these compounds can act as an electron shuttle, which of these compounds is binding with an organic pollutant, which, you know, so there's this challenge in that regard. And generally, we can assign areas where we make a Van Creveland plot, we have oxygen to carbon content of the molecules versus hydrogen to carbon. And the lignin material is right in this center when we look at a Van Creveland plot. However, here is a Van Creveland data from, this is Pony Lake, and here is the Suwannee River fulvic acid. Here's a picture of Pony Lake at Cape Royds in Antarctica. I mentioned I went to a plant-free continent. What does that mean? There's no lignin around, so we still have plenty of molecular formula in the center of this Van Creveland plot, so it must be coming from other degradation pathways, where then this is the Suwannee River, which is a very organic-rich cypress swamp in the northeast corner of Florida, southeast corner of Georgia. So we have to be careful as we interpret these data. And so I need to end right at 11, right? So I'm going to try to move through this last part pretty quickly. In terms of thinking about this redox cycling, we can go back to Lake Frixel in the Dry Valleys, which is, here's the Lake Frixel. Again, you notice no plants anywhere. And now look at how this profile of dissolved organic matter has changed. The ice cover results in the lake being stably stratified. The bottom water has a salinity close to seawater, and the water coming from the streams that flow into the lake is very fresh. And we see here's the conductivity profile, and here's the DOC profile that goes up to about from 3 milligrams per liter to 20 milligrams per liter in this profile. And this hasn't changed very much as we've been studying Lake Frixel over the years. And here's showing where the in vivo fluorescence related to chlorophyll is right above this oxycline. And then here is dissolved oxygen. It gets up to over 20 milligrams per liter because the ice cover is a barrier for gas exchange. And they're really photosynthesizing down there in the summer. If we look at iron profiles, there's iron throughout the water column, and there's a peak actually in this area across the chemocline. And so also notice it's very low oxygen below the chlorophyll maximum. Oh, one more thing I wanted to mention. Doing C14H, we know that this humic fraction at the bottom here is about 2,500 years old. So we can similarly collect a sample in a plastic bottle and hold on to it for a while. but in any event, we can look at how these eames change along the profile going down. And we published a paper in 2004 hypothesizing that the material in this low, no oxygen environment, that humic material will be acting again as electron shuttle across this oxycline, where the keeping the iron in the reduced state, and as it diffuses up, being oxidized into this high oxygen environment, that this DOC would be active in this way. And we saw that there was a redshift to these eames. So that means that the light is being emitted at a lower energy when the fluorescence is more focused on the, has been redshifted. And from looking at, Rose Corey looked at model compounds, both hydroquinones, which are reduced compared to quinones, we knew that this would also correspond to the quinone moieties being in a reduced state. Getting back to this idea that fluorescence is just not just a fingerprint. So I'm going to see, we went back to see how these, what do these eames look like now? And this is showing you how the eames change through time going from top to bottom. I think this isn't, I'm not going to explain this carefully, but I just, this is a precursor to the movie I'm going to be showing in a little bit. But another way to analyze, as I said, is using this FTICR mass spec. There's been an approach of developing, taking all these data and computing a nominal oxidation state of the organic carbon as a way to synthesize these many formula to see if they're related to the availability or the bioavailability of this material. And a higher value is more favorable than a lower value. It's kind of an interesting approach, because we don't know that all these molecular formula represent compounds that could even be taken up if you knew what their structure was. But it's an approach. The other nice thing about this approach is we can understand which are the heteroatoms that are associated with this material. Here, the purple is sulfur. So we can tell where the sulfur is in terms of molecules in this various position. But I want to emphasize that we're still limited. We have all these data, but we are still limited in actually interpreting it. We can make some comparisons, and we'll say, well, these slight change in the value for this NOSC from minus 0.2623 to minus 0.2687, is that really significant? Whereas we can look at some of these other tools and envision there's got to be a lot of biogeochemistry going on. So I wanted to put this out as a interesting but cautionary measure as we try to apply these tools. There's a lot for you young scientists to work on, and I'm not sure we need to use these techniques for drinking water yet in terms of applications. For example, in terms of comparing how this DOC may have changed, we know that the current elemental analysis shows there's a 1% sulfur content at 9 meters, but when and 4% at 19 meters, but when we sampled these in the late 80s, it was 2% and 8%. So there's been a huge change in the sulfur content, and we're not quite sure what's driving that. How is that related to lake level rise? Another important method on the horizon is all these in-situ sensors for doing FDOM and converting that to DOC, and that's very powerful. And you can buy some of these sensors for, they're very becoming more and more reliable and less expensive. And I think that's a very powerful technique. And that this potentially in combination with some samples that help us understand this might lead to a better understanding of how this phenomena is changing as there's so many changes in our landscape. So what I want to do now is show you a movie getting back to when I, that work? Let's see. This is about the last time I was in Minnesota. Now we're going to pour this out, see if it's brown. That results in humic material. The last time I was in Minnesota was to deliver the Pony Lake fulvic acid to Paul Bloom. And we met at a... So this was when I was here last. I delivered that Pony Lake fulvic acid. We met in a Chinese restaurant. I don't remember its name. We brought back 68 grams of Pony Lake fulvic acid in 2006. Kaylin Cawley is now with Neon. And guess what? It's all gone. We told our program officer that we're sure we had a reference material that would last for 25 years. Remember that? And it's in such high demand in terms of doing environmental chemistry because of things that are happening, that algal blooms, forest fires, nutrients, ice cover going out, that we have to have a plan to get another end member, whereas there's plenty of brown waters. We still have plenty of access to the Suwannee River. But I like to have this juxtaposition as these sources are different, but they're similar in many ways. So thank you very much. I'd be glad to take questions.
We have time for a couple questions. I have the little microphone here you need to use.
Hi, Diane. Thank you. Great talk. I had a question on the EAMS characterization of organic matter. I know you talked about them a lot, but I also know there's been some discussion in the organic matter field about how useful they are. And so I was wondering if you could comment on the use of EAMS for characterization of organic matter more directly.
So, again, I think there's, from an environmental chemistry point of view, they may seem very imprecise. From a limnological point of view, I'm wearing my limnologist ecologist hat. Limnologists have been measuring, for example, secchi disk depth. Do you know what that is? You put a white plate down and you record when you can see it. It's very useful for knowing how lakes work. The fluorescence index, the Hicks index, the Bix index are better than that in some ways, but they're like that. They're indices that allow people to compare across this wide array going from algal-derived to terrestrially-derived and be talking to each other. And everyone should also be measuring these indices for these two end members as they do their spectroscopy, because some of this, one of the challenges with the aqualog, this new fluorometer, is that if you don't have everything set up right, it doesn't give you the right fluorescence index for these reference samples. So you still have to be a careful spectroscopist. The thing about the Secchi disk analysis, it's really hard to screw that up. Whereas there's a lot of ways to screw up fluorescence. You need to, if your solution is too dark, then the light that was emitted will be absorbed along the path length. And so some measurements are wrong for that reason, and that greatly influences these indices because you miss the lower wavelength signal that's attenuated preferentially because the humic material increases in absorbance with decreasing wavelength. So you can screw it up. This parallel factor analysis approach is powerful, but can be done in parallel with these indices. And I think that we can use in parallel factor models that include that environment samples from many environments. So the Corey McKnight model that I showed you has 13 components. Many people do parafac analyses of oxygenated surface waters and only come up with 7. Well, they don't have any anoxic water where these fluorophores related to quinones will be redshifted. That's how their parafac models are different. So I think is very useful, and this is something. The other point I would make is these indices can be measured on 10 mils of filtered water. And if they're done smartly, where you keep track of the inner filter effect, they're more accurate than your DOC measure at when you're below 2 milligrams carbon per liter. That's hard to get a 15% accuracy. So that's my take on it. But it's an important question, and I think the chemists need to think more limnologically. Would you agree with that, Pat?
I think there needs to be more interwork.
Yeah.
Hi. So I had a question about how much we know about what happens when this DOM enters the hyporheic zone of a stream and what the effects will be on DOM and what happens further on as you have like a hydrologically active stream that might be gaining and switching between gaining and losing, and what's happening to the DOM? Do we actually know yet?
Matt Miller, the student who's work I presented, we actually worked on that in a stream up in the Colorado Rocky Mountains, and we could see that this humic material was more redshifted, the fluorescence was more redshifted, but animation that I showed you, I think that's the kind of process that would be happening. And it would be related to, do you have nitrate in the surface water and ammonia and nitrite in the bottom water, or the water coming in through the hyporheic zone. So this is an area where this can be a lot of reaction going on, and there's a lot of work to do that. And I think this, if the humic DOM coming into the hyporheic zone from the groundwater is in a reduced state, that can be an important energy transfer happening in that hyporheic zone, and because that represents an energy source promoting heterotrophic activity. Yeah.
Well, we have the poster session that's going to start here now, so let's thank Diane.
I want to thank Matt.
So there's